at bodyelectrician.com. I'll send you a PDF. I have a brochure and some information. But the secret is reversing the all environment. So look at this picture. If you've read, or I mean, if you've watched the movie What in the World Are They Spraying, you'll see a biologist on there, Mr. Mengel, talking about how the metals are altering the soil. So by reversing, by saturating the environment, the soil, with these elements that are no longer there, meaning the microorganisms and the minerals, you reverse the damage and actually build the plant immunity, build the nourishment value in the plant back up, and cause the plant to be healthier. So you're going to have less weeds, less bugs, more production, healthier plants, healthier food for you. It works the same way with your animals or with your body. You put the microorganisms back into your body, you saturate your body with minerals, get your digestive tract working, and the human body has the same potential to heal as the soil does, because we are part of the earth. So
thank you, Mr. Spencer. They're also coming out with the sequel to that movie, Why in the World Are They Spraying? And that's supposed to be coming out this year. They said if you buy one of the DVD, we can make multiple copies. So I thank you for what you're doing, and I just wanted to bring all that into the picture. So it's not just the bees are dying, but why are the bees dying? Why are the crops are dying? What can we do? And you have the answers. Thank you so much for answering my questions today.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling.
We have another caller for you, Will. Area code 641. Caller, you're live.
Yes. Is it possible to ask Drake a question, or should I call back on Sunday?
Calling back on Sunday would be better. I believe Drake has left the room.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot.
Uh-huh. Next, that was caller 641. Let's try caller 808. Caller 808, you're live.
Hi, my name's Dan. I also have I need to try to get in contact with Drake. I'm sorry.
That's okay. You may call back on Sunday.
Is there a way that someone from his group can give me a buzz? I have a very important message to share with him.
Send an email, can't they, Anita?
Yeah, do you have, what's the Freedomizer? I don't know it off the top of my head. What's the Freedomizer email? The subject could be for Drake, and you could send it to Freedomizer. It may be on the website. I'm sorry, I don't have that one memorized. If you listen as soon as, here it is. It's freedomrainusa@gmail.com.
Okay.
Okay. And you could put Drake. It's really just freedomrainusa.com.
Yeah. I've done that already in the past, and I've still yet not to hear anything back, so.
Well, try putting Ford Drake in the subject matter. Maybe that'll work better.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Following Drake's a hard act to follow. I'm telling you, everybody wants to talk to Drake today.
Well, yeah, but he certainly understands the ecology problems, doesn't he?
He does, because we work together in some research venues, so he's very aware of what's going on. I wish he wouldn't have left.
Well, I can tell you one thing. I was at a meeting in Ohio with the Natural Resources, and they were talking about the rivers in Ohio. And I was absolutely stunned, and this must have been 3 years ago, when they said all the rivers, and we have quite a few in our state, none of the rivers are safe for swimming. Not one. And, you know, you just stop and think about that, and you say, my gosh, what have we done?
We didn't do it. It's the industrialists that did it. And then the agriculture and the chemical brainwashing has been very thorough.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, in my state, I don't even know that they grow food anymore. And I have been told, and you can maybe answer that, Will, that this corn, the GMO corn, first of all, it's GMO, but it can't be converted to food anyway. I mean, it is not edible. So... They used to
I disagree.
Oh, you
disagree?
Okay.
We have, I'll bet, the one of the figures I heard, which was not a conservative figure, was 70%, this is another 70% again, of the food chain is genetically modified right now. And the reasoning is because high fructose corn syrup,
right.
soybeans, cottonseed oil, canola oil, is almost in almost all products. So,
yeah.
Therefore, if you just read the labels, which I encourage everybody to learn to read labels and look and start Googling what's in the food, they would be absolutely surprised if they haven't started doing that already.
Yeah. Well, I understand. Chris, are you on the line? You had some comments and questions? Is Chris's mic open? I guess not. We're kind of doing a tap dance here because the people on the board and I'm new at this. Please forgive me. I can't see the board, so I'm kind of counting on cues. But go on. I mean, in Ohio, we noticed this drastic change in Ohio. It used to be 1 year soybean, 1 year corn, 1 year soybean. I did a little research on this. I just kind of, when I saw that Bush, remember when Bush increased the amount of corn ethanol that he wanted produced by some gargantuous number,
uh-huh.
and we no longer saw alternating corn and soybean, we saw corn on corn. And I even went to a meeting at Ohio State University where the water people and a whole bunch of people were coming together and they were talking about the nitrates and corn on corn. And you know what? I don't think they were straightforward with the people in the room. I think that the corn growers probably have more clout in my state than the environmentalists, that's for sure.
That's pretty much across the board. The
yeah.
industrialists, those industrial-minded have the upper hand, if you will. The whole system's corrupt. My father, back in the 60s, converted from small farming to big farming. And still kept some of the small farming practices until he couldn't afford it anymore. But the university used to come out through the Farm Service Bureau, and basically they were just industrial salesmen, you know, with a university title.
Yeah.
And it was horrible watching that all take place. And then, you know, you couldn't make a living on 100 acres anymore. He ended up 3,000 acres. And still couldn't make it. Ended up selling completely selling out eventually in the 80s. But it's just horrible, and it was planned strategically this way, the whole system. So
to do this.
The damage is done. Now it's time to, you know, repair the damage and, you know, stop repeating history, you know, stop repeating this insanity.
Absolutely. Now, have you heard that a lot of us figured out that this you know, industrial corn is based on subsidies. I hear recently that they're going to cut the subsidies, which would certainly help solve some of that problem, would it not?
Well, I don't get into the whole politics of it.
Okay.
I consider that politics. I'm more into the what can we do about it now kind of theory.
Yeah.
The whole system is corrupt. I mean, the whole system, as in the whole industrial system that we live in today. It's just not the agricultural is included, the educational system's included, the politician, the government, the enforcing bodies. You know, it's all the same to me, because it's all corporations and it's all industrial, and they're all one company looking out for the other company to make sure that the American citizen doesn't have an upper hand.
Yeah, nor, you know, at least in my state, the people who want to grow food. I mean, I've talked to some of these people because I really am into local food, and they were saying that all the advantages are given to the corn growers of Ohio.
Well, that's fine if people would allow themselves to adjust their thinking, because big farming is not where it's at nutritionally, health-wise, or economically. I had a 40-acre farm for 8 years. I raised milk goats biodynamically. And by all means, I didn't have any state-of-the-art anything. And though my little farm made more money, in essence, than my dad's 3,000 acres of take-home.
Wow.
Because
wow, that's great.
So, and it's been proven time and time again that small farming, naturally working with nature, is will feed you more volume, will feed you more nourishment, will cut down on health costs, will cut down on all these other things. It's totally nonsense. And then this is what I love about this show is because people don't realize the information that you're being told here, the importance, I think, on a larger scale anyhow, because if you realize the power that you have by a little bit of education, because these statutes that they're coming out are only for the corporate aspect of you. They're not for you, the flesh and blood human. They're for the corporate entity that only exists on paper and in fiction and in Never Never Land that you keep attaching yourself to. So these laws that they're trying to force people to comply with, they're only getting you to comply with them because you're thinking you are the corporate entity of you when you're not. And this is where I hopefully there will be some more shows and education on that department here shortly to really help people grasp the strength and the power that you have by not consenting to their madness. This goes in healthcare and in food choices especially, because here I have friends in Pennsylvania that have been harassed by the U.S. Department of Agriculture through the Pennsylvania arm. And as soon as they gave their license back to the state and told them to go pound sand, you have no ruling and jurisdiction over me, they go away.
Are you kidding?
I swear to God.
You know,
I'll give you his phone number if you want to talk to him after the show.
Well, no, I certainly believe you, but that is such valuable information, because we had, you know, did you see that YouTube about that that gentleman, that farmer, that hog producer in Michigan?
Yeah, I've attempted to contact him to help morally support him, because they have no right to do that if you stand up to them. I had the same thing going on in Minnesota back in the 90s when I was selling my milk, because I sold raw milk only, and I sold cheese and other products off my farm. And I was being harassed a little bit until I said, wait a minute. Basically the same thing as here in Pennsylvania. You have no jurisdiction over me. I'm selling my product to the end consumer. You have no right to tell me anything. Go away. So as long as I did not advertise in the open market, I was all word of mouth. People came to me or I delivered mine to them. There was no problem.
Why?
You have to stand up to them.
Well, I agree. But why were you not free? Because you knew I'm kind of big on promoting local business. Why were you not free? I mean, I can understand if they start talking about commerce. They always tell us, well, if you go across state lines, yada, yada. But most of these people that you and I are talking about sell locally. Why were you not free to advertise locally? Or, I mean, why did they give you a hard time about that?
Well, the state rules at that time were you cannot advertise you're selling raw milk like that in the public arena, if you will, because the corporations own the media. The corporations own the lobbyists that get the laws passed. It's that big old circle. So, and there again, I didn't really need, I only advertised one time to push the issue, and that's when the inspector came out and tried to, you know, hassle me, and I figured I really don't need the extra sales, so I just quit and said, you know, I'll comply if you just go away and leave me alone.
Well, there is a program called Food Chain Radio. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. Michael Olson, I think, is his name.
No, I haven't.
Well, he has a lot of people. You know, maybe we can find a way to contact him, or you could be on his program, even better. But he gets a lot of these producers who call in, and I've listened to him with these horror stories of exactly what you're talking about, where the State Department of Ag or somebody comes in and shuts them down in Ohio, we have